It's now on RTE2 as we join Gay Byrne and Westlife for One Night Only.
Hello there, the last time I met you, you were all just babies.
Yeah, we've had an amazing life, and tonight we're going to, you know, go through the whole story and sing some of the songs that have defined our career, and of course, with the king of television behind us, it's going to be fantastic.
Tonight's show, meeting Gay Byrne, that's something that we've wanted to do for a long time.
Tonight is going to be a really honest night for Westlife. You're probably going to hear loads of stories that you haven't heard before. And, you know, I think it's going to be all about the fans tonight.
The last time we met Gay actually was when we performed on the Late Late Show, when he used to present it, we performed Fly Me Like Wings. So we've come a long way since then.
But what does it mean? What am I doing right now?
When I think that they were just young men when I first introduced them on the Late Late Show, it's wonderful to think of the success story that they've enjoyed, and they're going strong, and they're still as charming and delightful and considerate and gentlemanly as ever they were.
Hello there and welcome. And welcome, I believe, to what you will find a very special show coming to you from the studio tonight. Very special for our studio audience. Very special for me, and very special for our special guests and you at home, wherever you may be. Let's have a welcome, please, from Westlife.
Hard to find a way to get through. It's a tragedy, pulling at me like the stars do. You're like gravity, even if the wind blows. Makes it hard to believe how you got. Like a dream you had is real.
How you gonna live your life like a dream you had is real? you lost your way, I will keep you safe. We'll open up all your world inside, so you come alive tonight. I will keep you safe. Keep you safe. I will keep you safe.
Well, you know, I was so carried away, I nearly fluffed your name. I'm very sorry. But no, we got you on at the end anyway. How are you doing?
Good. Fantastic.
Very good to be here. Finally, we get an interview with Gay Byrne.
Yeah. It's just the top of the ladder now, is this everything from here down
on? We've done everything now, that's it.
Great, okay. Go back to the beginning. It seems to me that there was a... You are fairly well accustomed to appearing on stage.
Yeah. I think, well,
certainly.
Probably Cian in the Fesh, probably we would have been the youngest to start.
You're
on
the first
stage,
person. Actually.
Oh, no, he was only a baby at that stage. But a really good baby.
Yeah. A gold medal winning a baby.
He was winning cups at 4 years old.
But you'd done musicals,
We've done musicals in school, and we've done musicals in the local Hawksville Theatre as well in Sligo. And I think that's what kind of gave us our love for the stage. You know, I think for me anyway, like my first time on stage was in the Hawksville, and I was 12 years old. You know, myself
I was
and
in
Cian.
The audience.
Mark was in the audience watching us.
As a fan.
And he was a fan, in fairness.
Shane!
Like, one day.
I was like,
Cian!
I signed for you after.
Cian actually was in the same show as well. I seen both of them in it.
That must have turned off show business.
I was like, right, that's it.
What about you, Nicky?
I was, football was my love.
Yes,
from
Leeds.
Very
and
yeah, and I signed for Leeds, thankfully, as a teenager. Music was always in my life. My dad was lead singer in a band called Nicky and Studs in a cabaret band. So yeah, that was music. Was like, you know, always in my life. And later on, after Leeds, I actually set up a karaoke thing called Father and Son. So that's where it kind of led into the audition to meet all these lads, and then it all went downhill from here.
I could just see it. Got the whole world.
Well, that was 4 years of age. That was my first play in school. How did you know?
You've done your homework.
I was the role, the whole world in his hands, and I was to hold the globe, which was a sponge, you know, globe.
Did you drop it?
I didn't drop it.
You didn't.
I thought it'd be cool to make the world feel heavy. Yeah. So I remember kind of distinctly kind of going, struggling with the world like this. And I remember everybody laughing. I thought they were laughing because it was good, but obviously they weren't.
It was a blown world. Like, it was like.
It seems to me, though, there was a good musical tradition in Sligo.
Yeah,
there's a good sort of action there.
I think Ireland in general, you know, school is somewhere that music is heavily promoted. You know, every day, whether it's Tin Whistle or singing, you know, it's something that I personally done every single day in school anyway, and that it gave us all a fantastic kind of introduction and love for music. You know, just music for the sake of music, not pop music, and not wanting to be famous or on TV. Just the love of singing and the love of appreciation.
And you weren't out of step because you were involved in music. It was just taken as normal, as routine.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It was an everyday occurrence. You know, it was just the same as doing English and Irish and geography and stuff like that. Music, you know. And then, you know, in Sligo, we were lucky to have some fantastic local people who nurtured the youngsters that wanted to dance or sing. Once again, our school teachers in the school plays. We were just very lucky, and throughout my teenagers and all the boys as well, we used to be in musicals every single year. You know, even when we were doing our junior cert, they'd try and stop us, and we were like, no way, I don't care, the musicals are more important. And yeah, I mean, it was they very much promoted young kids in sport and music, you know, which is
fantastic. A good grounding, that's what it's called. I want to get this out of the way, because I want to take you back to that magic moment when you appeared on the late, late. Roll it there, Pat, please.
Just 3 weeks ago, under the guidance of the boys' own band guru, Louis Walsh, they cut a £4 million deal with RCA. £4 million. And would you welcome, please, Westside. You know how much work for the corporation, they don't think of their overcoats off, as you've noticed.
We look a bit different now, huh?
I suppose I should apologise for that remark all these years later, but there
you listen, are. Don't.
We counted that as our interview at the time, so.
What was the effect of that?
Of the long jackets.
They covered up my big belly at the time.
Of you being on the Late Late Show, what was the immediate effect?
Well, I mean, to us as children growing up, you know, to all of Ireland growing up, the Late Late Show is the one. It's the moment, you know, it's the you've made it if you're on the Late Late Show.
It's true.
And it especially true, yeah. If Gabe Byrne is interviewing you, you know. But you know, I think I remember when we did that show, it was obviously our first TV appearance in Ireland, and you know, Louis was backstage with us, and it was all like, it was such an exciting day, you know.
I think I got a nosebleed just before
you
that.
You did, yeah. You did get a bad nosebleed.
And you used Gay's hanky to wipe it off, remember that as well.
But just, to be honest with
pure
you, just
nerves.
Being on the Late Late Show, you know, I mean, and I suppose watching the boys on Success Story, and you know, knowing that their first TV show was always the Late Late Show, and then for us, it was like, oh my God, are we stepping into their shoes? Are we going to do what they did? I mean, the whole kind of image of it possibly happening, and that was kind of, I suppose it was step 3 or 4 of it all happening, from the Backstreet Boys supporting them in the RDS to, you know, signing a record deal to being on the Late Late Show. It was kind of the real feeling of it happening.
Was there a moment for you all that when you were thinking that this could work, I can sing, we can sing in a group, we can get a band. Was there anybody or any circumstances which confirmed in your mind that you could do it? This is doable.
I think the most important thing that we got Louis Walsh as our manager. I think that's, getting him was like, we were like, no, but in fairness, when we realized, he said to us, I want to manage you. And at the beginning he said, I didn't want to manage you because I didn't have time. But when he said he wanted to manage us, we were like, lads, we could be onto a winner here, you know? Well, literally, we were literally that excited. It was like, and then all of a sudden, like 4 days later, we were on the Late Late Show. It was like that. It was like, here we go, this is it. That's what it felt like at the time, you know?
Was that what,
yeah,
that
I think
was for you, Nicky?
It was the same, but you know, when I left Leeds, I wanted to be in a boy band. I was coming back to Ireland with shattered dreams, but I wanted to be in a boy band. But I didn't want to be in a boy band, funnily enough, that wasn't managed by Louis Walsh, because Boyzone were doing so well, and I just thought the rest, if he wasn't, you know, kind of really driving the whole train, then
no
it wasn't
going
to happen. And when I did the audition and met the lads, Louis picked me out of the audition and called me over and said, as we all know Louis now, he talks quite fast, and he said to me, you stay there, I want you in my next pub band, I want you in my next pub band. And I stood there going, pub band? And it was Louis Walsh, so I just went with it, you know?
Well, yeah, whatever.
Whatever you think.
So,
pub band.
Yeah, pub, well, he was saying pop band.
Pop band.
I only found that out a few minutes later. Like, I was standing there as his new protege in his pub band. So
tore all the pubs all across Ireland. Hear you.
By the way, what happened to the £500 Louis Walsh gave you to buy clothes? Get out of the
we probably didn't spend it all on clothes, but about, yeah. We probably went out to the pub.
Well, we came up from...
We went to Planet Hollywood, I think.
We came up from Sligo one weekend and...
on the train.
You know, it was like one of them weekends where we were coming up to meet Louis and discuss what was going to happen. And we went into BT2, I think it was, and he literally just gave us all £500 each to go shopping. And
500 quid each?
Yeah, yeah. We thought, we are loaded. We are like,
it's happened.
This is it. We have made it, like, literally. This
he probably doesn't even remember, you know?
This doesn't he sound like Louis. Yes, he does remember. He's told me about it,
really,
and he wants it back. Right. But I didn't know it was £500 each. I thought it was each. 500.
I'm pretty sure it was.
No, it was £500 each.
Hang on, maybe he got more. Keane was always the favourite.
Keane was the teacher's pet.
So, no, I don't know what that
we is. Went straight down to Henry Street with it.
Did you?
Bought all the fake clothes.
About 50 Ralph Lauren shirts.
And you are up and away and sailing. What's your next number now? What does this mean to you from that time, flying?
Flying with the Wings, I think, is a track that I think, well, it's debatable, but we think it's probably our best song we've ever recorded.
It was consecutive number one, yes.
It was record of the year.
Yes.
And I think it was a turning point for us as a band going forward. We felt when we won one record, we got number one with it, and then we won record of the year, I think it was a few weeks later. And we didn't think we were going to win it. And when we won it, it was like, this is it, you know, this is, it crosses over into a different audience. All of a sudden, like, mums, dads, everybody was into Westlife all of a sudden. And I think it was, without a doubt, that song that did it.
The applause will cover you as you make your way to the stage. Thank you. Go.
Everybody's looking for that something. One thing that makes it all complete. You find it in the strangest places, places you never knew it could be. Some find it in the face of their children. Some find it in the lover's eyes. Who can deny the joy it brings when you found that special thing? You're flying without wings. Some find a chair in every morning. Some in their solitary lives. You find it in the works of others. And a simple line can make you laugh. Oh, cry. You find it in the deepest friendship, the kind you cherish. Much that means, and you found that special thing. You're flying without wings. It's so impossible. This thing may seem you've got to fight for every dream. 'Cause who's to know which one of you? The sunrise on your face. To know that I can say I love you in any given time or place. And it's a little thing that only I know. Those are the things that flying without a wing.
Welcome back. I forgot to mention the Hallelujah Gospel Choir there with you, and they'll be back later on for another number and so on. Can we get rid of this Mariah Carey story that I picked up somewhere?
Which one is that?
There's a few.
Yeah. You know, you were asking us earlier, when did we really think we had made it? And actually, one of my childhood dreams was to sing with Mariah Carey. I was just a massive fan of her and her voice as well. And we were in what are you laughing at? We were in
Indonesia
or somewhere like that.
Indonesia, yeah.
And Cian came knocking on my door, or one of the boys came knocking on my door and said, you're not going to believe it, you're not going to believe it. And basically they were telling me that we were about to duet with Mariah Carey. So that was my kind of moment where I think I was like, right, I could go home right now and sort of give it all up and I'll have achieved my biggest dream in life, you know. So yeah, we've done that now and moved on to bigger and better dreams and goals. Okay.
Since you've made it now, all sorts of doors have opened and you're mixing with the biggest names in show business. Who do you trust?
We trust each other.
Each other,
yes. For sure. Unconditionally, that would be.
And then
yes.
Obviously our partners.
Yes.
Louis.
You trust Louis?
We trust Louis massively.
These boys are fools.
But at the end of the day, we're here because of him. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I know you are.
But,
yes.
He's very really, protective of himself. Outside of that.
Is he protective? He is.
Yeah,
yes.
Louis is very protective of
us. And we trust him to be honest, you know?
Yeah, he'll always be honest with us, even if it's the worst news that you don't want to hear. I'm just being honest. He'll just always say it. that's his famous line. Like,
I'm just being honest, Gary.
You know? And he always does it.
I
like it.
I do think as well, outside of that, you shouldn't really trust anybody because there's so many people doing it, working around what we do, and they will tell you what you want to hear. They will tell you that it's great. They'll tell you
that's
that it's
the
brilliant.
Danger.
And yeah, that is the biggest danger. And that's when, as Mark was saying, your feet start lifting off the ground when you start believing in the hype, you start believing what they're saying in the newspapers about you, you start believing you're more than what you are. At the end of the day, you're just a guy in a band singing songs.
Was Brian leaving a huge shock to you all?
Oh, shock. It was horrendous. It was like, it was just, we just never thought it could even happen. You know, it was like the perfect, we felt it was like the perfect band. You know, it was like, everything was going great. We couldn't have had more success. And then Brian, he literally just leaves one day. He said, can I talk to you tonight? I want to meet with you tonight. So we met up. We were staying in apartments in Dublin, myself, Cian and Mark. And we met up and he came into the room and he sat down and he just goes, lads, I'm hanging up my boots. And we were like,
what does that mean?
we were like kind of going, we literally all looked at each other. We didn't know what to say to him. We were like, are you serious? And he was like, yeah, no, I want to leave, like this. And then we actually thought it was the MTV punk show. We honestly thought we were being punked. I swear to God, we were like, he checked him for a camera. I was the guy, like,
am I on camera?
I was like, camera. We thought it was an MTV punk show. We had a chat for about an hour. He got up, he left. And the four of us sat there and we were like, what do we, you know, what
call
do we
Louis.
Do? We call Louis. Louis goes, I'm on the way, I'm on the way.
Louis did not. I had to meet Louis. I drove out and met Louis because he goes, I don't know where I'm going on the north side of Dublin.
I've never been over the north side before.
And he came in, he walked in, he goes, Brian left, he goes, so what? There's only four in the Beatles.
This is a good point.
That was it.
And it's also accurate.
Yeah. But you know, in fairness to Brian, just to finish off, you know. He was going through. Kerry, his wife at the time, had just won I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here. His profile as a couple, as an individual, had rocketed. And I think, you know, he was just, he was 23 years of age, we all were. And, you know, looking back on it now, nearly 8 years ago now, in March, you know, it's crazy to think that it was that long ago. But, you know, I don't know if he was thinking straight at the time either. You know, this is probably a mature view on it now. I think he's, you know, to look back on it, he's never said he's regretted it. But I think, you know, when you kind of decide something that major on such a whim, you might have regrets. And I do feel sorry for him in that respect because, you know, he's very happy now. He's living in LA / Sydney with Delta. I mean, she's gorgeous and they're very, very happy together. So, you know, and we do keep in contact with him.
Okay. Yeah. Now, you're very good to your fans and... that confirmed that. On 2FM, we put out a call about people who wanted to be here tonight. And to say that the response was robust is to put it lightly.
Okay.
So anyway, we were surprised by the number of people who actually wanted us to do something on behalf of friends who were madly in love with you. Have a look at this. Roll it there, Pat, please. Westlife fans from all over the country wanted to be here tonight.
Westlife are my life. I've been there, they've been there since I was 6, 7, and every time I see them, it gives me, like, oh, shivers, because they're just amazing.
You were always there by my side.
like, in 13 years you get a lot of memories. I mean, there's lots I could choose from. I supported them from day one. I was there at the auditions and all their other showcases that they did for Simon Cowell. And I was there for everything, everything.
All right, guys, out three, you ready? 1, 2, 3, go!
My 30th, I was told, was a special guest arriving. The last song that was played was Flying Without Wings. And in came a cardboard cutout, life-size, of Shane Filan. Look at him, what's not to love? He's absolutely gorgeous.
And we were inundated with emails from people who wanted to surprise some of their loved ones as well.
I nominated Chloe to see Westlife this evening because she has loved Westlife for years and years, and I thought this being her 21st birthday, it would be a great way to celebrate it.
Shauna has been a devoted fan. She has rescheduled a once-in-a-lifetime trip to Australia. She rearranged her 21st birthday party. Everything is planned and arranged around their concerts.
Michelle is a wonderful person. She is so thoughtful. She thinks of everyone else but herself.
They're all her favourites, but there's one song that stands out and I think that links both of us. And that would be Queen of My Heart.
I'm a fan myself. I love them myself.
Arlene's, there's maybe not enough adjectives to, you know, kind of describe how nice she is and what she means to me. You know? And she's talked a long time about it will be one of her life goals or long time dream, you know, to meet Westlife. If she's happy, I'm happy.
Okay. Sinead, where is Sinead? Are you there, Sinead? Oh, there you are. Hello, Sinead. Now, you... yes, this is the lady. Sinead is... Now, Sinead is the lady who goes to bed every night with a cardboard cutout of Shane. Which, I must say, it strikes me as an odd way to
live. He's a bit damaged right now, actually.
Well, will you...
I meant the cardboard.
Sinead, you got yourself into it, get yourself out of it. Okay. Now, did you you have him in person, so what do you want to say to him?
Give us a kiss.
That's enough. You're a married man. Go back to your seat at once. How dare you? Disgraceful behaviour. If I'd known it was going to be like this. Bernard, where is Bernard? Oh, there you are, Bernard. Yes, hello, Bernard. Now you have to suffer this beautiful woman being madly in love with which one of these?
Shane Filan.
Shane, I see.
Hello, man.
How do you cope with this, Bernard?
Very well.
Not very well, Gay, not very well. It's very hard to compete with a multi-millionaire who has been successful for 10 years.
Well, what do you want to say to her or to them?
Well, there's a couple of things that I'd love to get a picture for with Shane and Arlene, but there is something that I have ulterior motives for being here tonight. So, I'm sorry to hijack the show and the fellas, but there was something that I wanted to ask Arlene. Just in... So, just to make the evening a bit more special, just in front of everyone and the fellas from Westlife, Arlene.
Whoa! Congratulations, mister. Well done. Well done. There you are. There you are. Sit down. Well, how about that then?
She did say yes, did she?
Yeah, well, no, I heard her saying no, as a matter of fact. He's pressing ahead. Well, wasn't that an exciting moment? Yeah. Now,
That's great.
It occurred to me, Brian did intimate recently, sorry, I mean your shadow, that he would like to come back and do an album with you. What's your quick reaction to that?
He said on Twitter that he wanted to come back and do an album with Westlife. I mean, at the end of the day, Brian is a fantastic guy. We love him to pieces. We do, however, feel that, you know, he left Westlife for a reason. He was very unhappy in Westlife.
Yep.
And it was a very, very, very long time ago. And we're not saying that we'll never, ever do anything with Brian again, but this is Westlife.
End of story.
And that's it.
Say no more. What's your next number? And why?
Don't know. You tell us.
Something about raising us up.
Oh, yes, yes. Okay. Yeah.
The choir are in place.
Can we dedicate it to the newly engaged couple, please?
Why not? Isn't that wonderful? Go, 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 go. Do that. Well done. Another world.
12 years ago, only Louis Walsh could have predicted the success that Westlife have achieved worldwide. These four young Irish lads became global superstars through hard work, perseverance, and the faith to follow their dream. But Westlife have grown from boys to men. They are now boyfriends, husbands, and fathers. That as a dramatic change in lifestyle. Now this is it, and this is what's important. Yes.
You know, I think we all sat down as a group there recently, maybe a year ago, and probably myself and Shane had to explain, you know, the kind of fundamentals of daddyhood and how it was going to take an effect on Westlife as we knew it, and that was an important situation I think for us all to have that conversation to have, because we didn't want it to end. But we certainly couldn't continue to do it as we did it. You know, we just needed to go, well, look, we can do all the work, we just need to squeeze it up. And I think, like, we touched on it briefly earlier, but I think we've managed to do
it. It strikes me you're doing pretty good on all of this. Is there a sense now that it's really all for the kids from here on?
100%. Your kids come to see you now in concert, and that just it just melts your heart. You know, the three of them are,
really?
You know, my three kids are down with the earmuffs on them and Rock on Jerry there, and they're singing, and they're like, it's an unbelievable proud feeling. It's a feeling that our parents feel looking at us on stage, and it's the first time that you realise how proud our parents are of us. You know, you get that kind of fatherhood feeling, and you're looking down going, oh my God, like I wouldn't give this up for the world, purely for my kids, you know, because it is an amazing life that you can give them because of Westlife.
Saying that, Jay did tell me he wanted to be Shane instead of me, so that's very scary.
Obviously, you know, I don't have children yet, but you know, I'm newly married, and I really look forward to the day of having children. I mean, for me and for my wife Jodie, you know, we have other things going on in our lives that at the moment we feel we want to do that before we get to that stage. I always say to Shane, I feel like I'm almost 5 years behind him, you know, from getting married to building houses to having babies. So I definitely feel like it's something I really want in my life, obviously, as a married man, and I really look forward to it. But it just doesn't feel like it's right for me just yet as an individual. I don't feel like I'm ready for it just yet.
How about you, Mark? You've become something of an icon for young men coming out. What is this? Is this in any sense a burden to you now?
No, not a burden at all. I mean, when I first came out, I was kind of a bit, I just found it weird to be called like a role model. You know, I kind of made me nervous because I was sort of, it made me nervous because I thought, oh God, that means I have to, like, you know, do all the right things and say all the right things all the time. But then I kind of finally realized that actually being a role model is actually just being myself and being happy in life and being an example of, you know, someone that, well, to be honest, struggled with their sexuality and then arrived in a place where they got through that struggle and they became very happy and fell in love, and basically sort of a kind of maybe a representation of the fact that, you know, things can get better and things will become okay, because sometimes it can be quite difficult to see that positive potential outcome, you know, especially when you kind of, you know, you can build a wall up around yourself and get into a very dark place. So if I'm a role model to show people that you can come out of that and be very, very happy on the other side, then I'm very happy with that, and it's not a burden at all, you know.
Good, well done. Well done. Great. Now, what about now?
What about today?
What about today? What about now? What about this song sums up all of that kind of thing,
I think,
does it?
You know, for Westlife, this was the song that we came back with after a year off. And, you know, after the year off, we come back as four guys kind of going, right, we've done all the things that, shall we say, we've dreamed of. You know, we've played Crow Park, you know, we've sold all the albums, we've made a lot of money, we've done all the good things, all the things that you dream of as a child. Now let's make it about, what do we want out of this? And for the last album, What About Now, and the album Where We Are, it was very much about what we wanted to listen to ourselves, what music we loved, what we wanted to have great, amazing pop music. And, you know, we feel like the last album and this new album, Gravity, are two of our best albums simply because we got really fussy as people. As music fans, ourselves, we were going, no, that song isn't good enough. That song is good enough. And we became very, very fussy of what we were going to record. We learned how to say no, very much so. We said, no, we're not recording that cover. We're not recording that cover. Yeah, with a full stop.
Capital letters.
And, you know, this song, What About Now, even though it was a cover, was a song that we were like, wow, this is an amazing song. And this feels fresh. It feels new to us. And this was the first single off the last album, and we feel it was kind of the first single of the second chapter of Westlife's career.
Would you like to hear it?
Yeah! Go, 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 go!
What About Now?
Shadows fill an empty heart as love is fading from all the things that we are but are not saying. Can we see beyond the scars and make it to the dawn? Change the colors of the sky and open up to the ways you made me feel alive, like the ways I loved you. Things that never die, to make it through the night, love will find you.
Sing it!
What about now? What about today? What if you're making me all that I was meant to be? What if our love never went away? What if it's lost behind? Words we could never find. Maybe before it's too late. What about now? The sun is breaking in your eyes. Start a new day. This broken heart can still survive with the touch of your grace. Shadows fade into the light. I am by your side, where love will find you. What about now? What about today? What if you're making me all that I was meant to be? What if our love never went away? What if it's lost behind? Words we could never find. Maybe before it's too late. What about now? Now that we're here, now that we've come this far, just hold on. There is nothing to fear, for I am right. What about today? What if you're making me all that I was meant to be? What if our love never went away? What if it's lost behind? Words we can never find. What about now? What about today? What if you're making me all that I was meant to be? What if our love never went away? What if it's lost behind? Words we could never find. Maybe before it's too late. Maybe before it's too late. Maybe before. What about now?
Thank you.
Yo-ho! Woo-hoo!
matter of interest, who decided that was a good song and who decided we were going to record
Simon
it?
Kell.
Yep.
Simon said it was a good song and we decided to record it.
Yeah, you know, it was Simon. We used to do everything that Simon said. Like, Simon said.
We thought it was a game.
We did. Fairness to him, he didn't actually ask us to record that song. He kind of said if we could find, you know, this is the style that I think you need to come back with for the next part of your career. And we spent the whole 3-4 months making the album, and then at the end of it we thought, why don't we just record What About Now? And we did, and you know, I think we're safe to say that
good
it
one.
Was brilliant.
Good one. And so you start touring now next year.
That's right.
You're in the O2 in April, I know, but apart from that then, you're starting on the slog.
Basically, yeah, I think up to Christmas though is probably the hardest part of the year.
The promotion is the bit where you're just talking all the time. Touring, you're singing and performing, and album recording, you're, you know, being creative and recording and singing as well. So the promotion part is the bit where there's 90% talking and not much performing. So, you know,
that's when the arguments happen.
Yeah, it is true that every year we probably have more arguments in November, December than we do have for the rest of the whole year. It's incredible.
You're not busy enough. You're not doing what you're supposed to do.
This is it. Like, we're trying to promote something. We're very passionate about it and blah, blah, blah. But when it comes to after Christmas, that's when the fun starts. You know,
suppose I was to sling something at you out of all of this 12 years on the road. Let me sling something. What have you learned about yourselves, about life, about people, about the business, about...
I think, for me personally, you've just got to be happy in life. You've just, you know, whatever it is that actually makes you happy in life, whether it be in Westlife or even not be in Westlife, you've just got to be happy. We're all here for a very limited time. We're all here for, we've got one shot at life. Just be happy.
Nikki.
Hard to beat that.
No, I think how incredibly lucky that we all are. We all have our health. We've seen the world a billion times. We've made a few quid. We're, you know, all happy. And I think that's the biggest thing you can take. You know, if you don't have that, you're in trouble. You know what I mean? So I think, you know, we're lucky and we're healthy.
Good. Okay.
I definitely think the two boys nailed a lot of probably what I was going to say, but I think for me, if you believe in something, I think follow your dreams, without a doubt. I don't think, we never thought we'd be a band coming from Sligo, we never thought we'd be on the Late Late Show, never mind, you know, sell what we sold and travel the world for 12 years. I think just believe in what you believe in and follow your dreams, and if it's meant to be, it'll happen for you.
Mark?
I mean, it's been an amazing journey, you know what I mean? And I've learned so much, you know. 18 years old, naive, kind of, you know, rural Ireland, growing up. I didn't know what hit me when we moved to London and stuff like that. But I've just learned that actually your life is in your own hands. And I think to a certain extent anyway, your own destiny is in your own hands. And you have to sort of stand up and take control of that and be... You know, be in control of your own life. You know, a lot of people sit back and sort of wonder why X, Y, and Z is happening to them. But actually, if you can actually get up and change it. So, I mean, it's not the case for everyone, but a lot of people are in positions that they're not happy in, can actually do something about it, you know. And I think that's one thing I've learned. And also, it's all about balance. It's not all about record sales. It's not all about home life. It's a bit of a balance of the both, you know. It's balance of happiness, it's a balance of being professional, hard work, but also rest, you know. It's just a balance of everything. Instead of too much of anything can be, you know, can throw things off.
Okay, ideally for the future, how many more years do you want to give it?
60.
Hooray! 60 would be nice.
It's very hard to answer the question, honestly, again, because for us, we love doing it, you know. We want to do it for the next 20
12.
Years. No, but if another 12, if we could, of course. But
it's a fair question, a fair answer. Yeah, another 12.
Another 12 would be why fantastic.
I want you to do this next number, and while you do it, I'll cover and wrap this show for tonight and thank our audience and so on. But why? I'm sorry, but I will reach you. What's the special significance of?
It's a song for a new album, Gravity, and it's...
A song that Mark wrote?
Well, yeah, I was involved in the writing of it, but, you know, it's not all about that. I think we all like it. It's an original Westlife song. It's upbeat, it's uplifting, it's meaningful. And
great pop song.
The rest is just, it's just pop music, really. Like, there's not much point in explaining too much about it, you know.
Okay. Go and do it, and I'll do the rap.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
God bless you all.
Thank you very much.
Now, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, I forgot to mention earlier on, but the boys, this is their new album called Gravity. Woo! And believe it or believe it not, there's one for everybody in the audience. All right. In wrapping up the show for tonight, I know that you'll all join me in saying that what we wish for the boys, this is only the start of the next 12 years. And what we wish for them at the end of this particular whirlwind of 12 years, in the next 12 years, that they stay happy and healthy and successful and wonderful. Okay. We'll say goodnight with this final song. All right, thank you for being here. Thank you for being such a lovely audience. I know the four boys absolutely appreciate it. Over to you to say thank you.
Everybody's got an answer to a question that they need to know. Still broken over one thing I didn't ask you. Do you have to go? And now I'm looking for a reason. It isn't easy, but I gotta have hope. Sometimes it can be harder to remember than to just let go. Always looking for the one thing to remind me what I miss the most. Cause you are the one thing I believed in when it all falls down. Oh yeah. So if you got a candle, you better light it now. And if you got a voice, you better shout out loud. Raise your heads above this crowd. I can feel you after all this time. So maybe if you're hurting, all I'm asking for is just one sign. Cause I never met anyone who was lost but didn't wanna be found. Oh yeah. So if you got a candle, you better light it down. And if you got a voice, you better shout out loud. Can you hear me? I will reach you. Can you hear me now? Lighting up. I will reach you. Shout out. This crowd, and I will reach you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Thank you. Good night. Thank you, Gabe.
How are you?
Thanks, Alan.
Now we face the darkest day. Back the tears inside. But I can't turn this page or roll back the time. It's too hard to say goodbye.
say goodbye.